considered one singular student-level problem as to say. So today we will discuss the second one, which is related to the Bessel differential equation. Okay, so there is a family of Bessel differential equation, and described by so-called order name. Right? So we have x plus prime. Usually we fix a parameter new called the order. Okay, so and the lambda, so we fix a new here. Okay. And now we will try to find possible lambda such that there exists a non-trivial solution. So if we have any such lambda, then that lambda is called an eigenvalue. Okay? Right? So an eigenvalue. And here, mu is fixed. It's fixed. Okay? And now, this is equal to, our answer is possible. X equals 0, it's a singular point. Of the, so this one equals 11.5.16 of the Bessel equation. For the surface of the okay. When written in the normal form. Y prime plus 1 over x y prime plus minus mu square s square plus lambda y is 0. So this is the normal form of this second order homogeneous linear differential equation. Right, and so you can see that the coefficient for the coefficients functions, you see that when x equals 0, this is 1. So we know x equals 0, this is 0.1. That's why when we describe this ODE, right, we cannot include the left endpoint here. But it is very safe to include the right endpoint B. Because for B here, when x equals B, you can see that the both coefficient functions are well defined. So there's no problem. Alright, so now we list the related function. So we know P of x is x, mu of x, minus mu square. Alright, because we express this one as a student-level ODE, right? So this is a student-level equation. And we know R of x equals x, okay? Right, so this is our list of PQR. And we know P of x, is continuously differentiable in this cross interval, right? So P of x, because it's a polynomial function, so it is continuously differentiable on the finite cross interval, including the endpoint. So fine. So P of x is that, and we know R of x. Of x here, of course, we can require is continuous, okay, and P of x greater than zero, of x greater than zero, okay, zero b, right? But this is only, but not include that endpoint zero, right? So this is open. Although Q of x is continuous, okay, the left half open, half closed interval, it is bounded. That is unbounded near the endpoint x equals to 0. Okay, so this Q of x is here. So when x is near to 0, then Q of x becomes to unbounded. Also, we know P0, QR0 equals to 0. So at this endpoint 0, P and R will not be positive anymore, but they are equal to 0. Right. So we know the basal ODE, okay, is a singular. Right. So it's a singular Sturm Liouville equation. Okay, so we should put suitable boundary conditions at x equal to 0. Okay, at the left endpoint. Because we are pretty safe with the right endpoint B. We have no problem with that. Okay, so we will put the regular boundary condition at x equal to B as before. But we should find a suitable boundary condition for the left endpoint 0. Before we can discuss further, we have to find the solution of the basal ODE. And we did that in the course of ordinary differential equation by the so-called Frobenius method. I hope you still remember this method. This method actually is an extended Hall series method. We have used the Hall series method to solve the Zander ODE last Tuesday. But today we have to use the Frobenius method to solve the basal equation. So the basal of the E, alright, of order nu. Okay, so this is the basal of E of order nu in 11.1.p as a general solution. y edge, okay. C1 j nu x the lambda, because we have a parameter lambda. If you look back to the ODE, the Bessel equation has been put in the form that lambda equals 1. Okay, so when you solve the classical problem, the lambda is set to be 1. But here, because we want to discuss the Sturm-Liouville problem, so the lambda here can be any real number. Okay, and then we will see that what kind of lambda, what kind of lambda do we have, so that this Bessel ODE has non-trivial solution. Of course, we have to give the order nu fixed. Okay, order nu fixed. Okay, so now we have when you go through the solution of this Bessel equation, even though you have a general lambda here, the method, the procedure or the process when using the Frobenius method were almost the same. Okay? So I just put a lambda here as a parameter. And we can write down. What is the J function? X nu summation So if lambda is equal to 1, this is just the ordinary Bessel function of the first kind of order nu. Okay, if lambda is equal to 1. Okay, so when lambda equal 1, this is just the so-called Bessel function of the first kind of order nu. Also, and we can put minus nu. X to the minus nu power summation k to the root k minus nu is factorial gamma function k minus nu plus 1 x to the root k power. Now, so this is gamma function. Okay? And I hope you know gamma function before, right? If you don't, please raise your hand. Oh, yeah. Okay? Thank you. All right. So that's fine. Okay. So let me, gamma function, this is down here. Okay, the gamma function. Alright, it's defined. Okay. That's an integral, okay. So it's defined by the gamma of x defined from 0 to infinity e minus e to the minus t e to the x minus 1 dx for all x greater than 0. Okay? So first of all, we define the gamma function for all non-negative value of x, okay, by this integral. Of course, this is an improper integral because it goes to infinity, right? And we can show by elementary technique that this integral exists. And the reason is that exponential function decay very fast. So even though you have something like t is my mistake. Even though this is a polynomial terms, but it decays very fast. So actually, as t goes to infinity, it decays to zero very fast. Alright, that's why this is the true. Alright, so I just don't want to do the proof why this integral exists, but if we can, from intuition, you know that this is true. Okay, now so we define x for this is the situation. Now, but how about other real x? Okay, so now we have to work with complex analysis. So we will talk about that almost at the end of the semester. The technique called analytical continuation. In complex analysis. Alright, so we will mention I try my best to mention analytic continuation when we discuss the complex variable. Alright, so in complex analysis that it can be extended, alright, to be a complex valued function. A gamma z, alright? Because for a complex value function in complex variable, we usually use z, okay? Right? Defined on the complex plane. Alright, so we can define this complex value function defined on the complex plane. Except with pole, with pole means that it will diverge at z equal to 0, minus 1, minus 2, etc. Okay? Etc. And the gamma function has the following property. That gamma z plus 1 equals z times gamma z for all z in the complex plane minus 0. Okay? Because that at the non-positive integers, the gamma function will diverge to infinity. Okay. But for others that other value in the complex plane, the gamma function is well defined. So it's very interesting. Let me draw the picture. Even though we will see that later. So this is the complex plane. So we have x here, we have y. Alright? And originally, we can define gamma function here. Alright? So we define gamma x, okay, for x greater than 0. So originally we just can define values on this real axis, but just positive. Okay? And then by so-called analytic continuation, we can continue. We can from this point to go to any and then up here. We can go up here. Okay, by so-called by analytical continuation. So we can find many different paths. Through different paths, we can find the value. So at any point, we can define the value gamma z. Z here, z equal to x plus 1. Okay? Except that we cannot define 0. These are poles. So 0. Minus 1, minus 2, minus 3, minus 4, etc. So except we have pole. We have pole. Pole means that the value will diverge. So you don't have any specific value. So now, but other point in the complex plane, we can define a value by so-called the analytical continuation. Right? So this is the technique I will try. To describe that at the end of the semester, and so especially now for real parameters, the gamma function has value here. Okay, right? So you have value by the extension. Okay. So that's. X R, but except 0, minus 1, minus 2, etc. Okay. It's well defined. And we can draw the picture. I hope I still remember the picture. So we have all here. So we have something like so this is the gamma function. Okay. So that is the gamma function. Okay. So this is the picture, the figure of the function. Okay. So that, something like that. This is shifty. So I just hope you have this image about the gamma function. Just like that. Okay. Alright, so this is about gamma functions here. So you can see if nu, okay? Nu here is an integer. Because nu always greater than or equal to 0, right? So if nu is a non-negative integer, then you have a danger, because that in that case, if nu is 3, all right? Now k, the integer, if the k is less than 2, so if, for example, k is equal to 2 minus 3 plus 1 is 0. So gamma 0 is undefined, okay? It's undefined, and then this Bessel function of first kind will be in danger. But For engineer, we will think about because it appears in the denominator, right? And because at this point, it is going to either minus infinity or plus infinity, right? So we can think about this is infinity. And so the ratio is zero. So we can interpret that as some term is here. Okay? And in that case that this is also defined. If we interpret the j minus mu in this way, then it's also well defined. So we can prove. As you know, in ODE, we can prove that equal to very interesting. We have this identity for all n. Okay, n zero. N zero means integers greater than or equal to zero. Okay. So we have this identity. And so these two, the j minus n and j will be linearly dependent. They will be linearly dependent. Okay. But if nu is not a non-negative integer, then from here, because you have x to the nu power, here you have x to the minus nu power, then these two, the j nu and the j minus nu, are linearly dependent. So that's why we can write down the general solution. Okay. So we have to be very careful in this case that so we can write down the general solution. General solution when right? So we write down the general solution as a linear combination of these two functions because they are independent when nu is not an integer. Okay? Alright, so we can write them. So we have to treat in some special way for nu equal to n. Okay? Cool. When they are. So when nu is equal to n, n is 1, etc. A general solution. Alright, a general solution is, remember, in this case, a general solution is that C1 is also, we have Jn. Not that, okay? We have Jn. But the other one, because J minus n, is linearly dependent with Jn. Okay, so you cannot write J minus n, right? So we have to resort to the Bessel function of the second kind, the 1. I hope you remember that. Okay, so you have. Okay, so we have here. Okay, I forgot to put one more. Also, there is one gamma. So special. So gamma n plus 1 by the recursive functional formula. By the functional formula, gamma n plus 1 equal to n. Gamma n equal to n times n minus 1, gamma n minus 1, etc. up to 2, 1, and gamma 1. Okay? But what is gamma 1? 1. And this is 1. X is 1. So cancel. So you have an equation of this exponential function. And this is very easy, right? The integral is 1. Okay? So this is equal to n integral. Because since gamma 1 okay, so when mu is integer, it's n, so you will encounter integer. So the when mu is n is n here, right? So when mu is n, this is integer. So let me write down x to n power k from 0 to infinity minus lambda x power 2 to the 2k plus n k factorial, and here is k plus n factorial and x to k. Okay. And what is that? Because since gamma k plus n plus 1 is equal to k plus n factorial, okay? And here, by this formula, right? And this is related to the Bessel function of the first kind of order n with parameter lambda here. Okay, so in this expression, you don't need to define gamma function, right? Just use factorial. So maybe this is the reason why you don't know what is gamma function, because that maybe your instructor in ODE course just discuss the Bessel function of the first kind of integer order. Okay, just integer order, so that's why here. And the yn, okay, so the second kind, the Bessel function of the second kind is a little bit complicated. Okay, so I write it carefully. So we have the Bessel function of the first kind of order n with parameter lambda times with gamma. So this is gamma. Okay, right, times this vector plus x to the nth power. Right of pi with an infinite series. It's complicated. Hk plus h k plus n divided by 2 to the 2k plus n k factorial k plus n factorial x to the k power. And the plus minus a finite sum, that is pi summation k zero minus 1. So this is a finite sum. H0 is defined to be 0, Hm is defined to be 1 plus m for all m greater than 1. And what is gamma? Gamma is defined to be the limit for m goes to infinity of Hm minus log n. We call the Euler constant. So that is the explanation that we have. So you know why we need the Bessel function of the second kind. Because if new, if the order is integer, alright? So the basic thing is that the Bessel function of first kind of order minus n is a proportion to the Bessel function of first kind of order n. Okay, so we need the second kind. And hopefully, you can see that the second kind is truly a little bit complicated here. Okay, so I try to write it down. Right? And it is necessary to write down the solution because I need to use the solution explicitly. Now I have some words to say about it. This solution. First of all, by root test, you can see that look at the series part, not including this polynomial term, the power term, sorry, not polynomial, power term. Alright, this one. Okay? It is a power series, right? It's a power series. So the RC is what? It's infinite. By root test. Again, by root test. It means that this power series converge for every x in the real one, okay? For every x. So this is. And the set, okay, for here, the RC was the infinite. Alright? How about that? This one? Okay, so when you look at this part, the ROC is also infinite, okay, by the root test. So they are all infinite. If we look at this is finite sum, so there is no problem of convergence, no problem. But if you have infinite sum, an infinite power series, then you have to take care of the region of convergence, radius of convergence. So this is alright, so you know all these pictures. Okay, so now since Q of x is minus mu square x is unbounded, okay, near the end point x equals 0, and a solution y of the Bessel ODE of order nu may be unbounded, okay, near S equal to 0. Wow. Look at this solution. Because nu, if nu is, we say nu is positive, right? Non-negative. Suppose nu is positive, right? And so minus nu is negative. Okay? So when x goes to 0, this term, this power term goes to infinity, right? Even though this infinity series converges, right? Because this is converged for every real x. Alright, but this one diverged to infinity. Alright, so this solution is unbounded near x equals 0. Alright, so for nu, which is not non-negative integer. If nu is non-negative integer, like this one, okay, like this one, the second kind, we have this term, right? This converge, no problem, right? Because this is polynomial, this is non-negative. and this is converge. This one converge too, but this term diverge because minus n here. So for n is not equal to right. So we know that some of the solution of the Bessel ODE may be unbounded. Right. So the integral from 0 to b for a function should be interpreted as right, so I have to erase R. Okay, so it can be interpreted as an improper integral. So AB, zero to B, f of x, dx, will be interpreted, defined to be the limit, epsilon goes to zero, from epsilon to B, f of x, and dx. Okay, so we will interpret the integral as the improper integral. Now, so when we look back the Lagrange identity, okay, in the proof of the adjoint property of regular equilibrium operator. Okay. The Lagrange operator comes to x because R of x is x, and L of u minus from u b x u b. Okay. So this is the limit epsilon goes to zero. So now, for every positive epsilon, we know everything just fine. Just like a regular case, right? Just like a regular case. So they are fine. And so we find that we have P of x, u prime of x, 3x, minus ux, 3 prime of x, and this is b and the epsilon. Okay, so we have that. Now, for an epsilon go to zero, p epsilon go to zero because px is x. So p epsilon go to zero. Okay, and this is go to zero, so we just require that u prime v and the u and v prime, they are bounded near x equal to zero. Okay, so we require they are bounded, right? Okay. So but things limit P of epsilon is equal to which is zero, we will have, okay, so we will have zero to P x L of u V P x minus zero P x u L of V P x. This one becomes true. So we have Okay, so now this is going to zero. Okay, because this goes to zero, if we impose the boundary conditions that the following boundary conditions. One, at zero, U prime, U, V, and U prime, V prime. Are bounded, okay, near the endpoint x equals 0, right? This is first. The second, and one. U A U B at a 2 U from B to 0 and at a 1 V B plus L 2 U from B is 0. So this is the second part of the regular boundary condition. So at the So at x equals b, we just require u and v satisfy the regular boundary condition. Okay. So we have L1, L2, and with L1 squared plus L2 squared not equal to 0. So at least one of L1 and L2 are non-zero. Okay, so if this is true, then we know this is equal to 0. When 2 is true, this is equal to 0. No matter what is this value, but this is 0. And if U prime are bounded near 0, then because this is called bounded, and by this one goes to 0, so this limit goes to 0. Okay, and so we have this 0 here. So we were able to prove that the corresponding Sturm-Liouville operator L will be self-adjoint again. Okay, will be self-adjoint. So we import these two conditions. Okay, so we let V B the Bessel space consists of all real value functions U zero B such that okay so on the half open, half closed, okay? One, U is continuously differentiable on this interval. Second, that U prime is absolutely continuous. It's half open, half closed interval, which implies that the second derivative will be from x of ux exists for almost all on x in the B. third thing, that U double prime is square integral over this half, open half course interval. And the first one is the boundary condition that U and U prime are bounded, right, near x equals 0. And we require U be a simple bound equals 0. So, so this is the a special kind of boundary condition, regular boundary condition. Okay, so we just put U be equal to 0 to simplify our discussion. Okay, but this is indeed the case studied by Fourier, okay, by Fourier, and so we call it a Bessel space. Other case means that when L2 is non-zero, it's being discussed by any. Okay? And a little bit complicated, I try to write into my notes, but okay, but I have the supplement I sent you a few days ago. Discuss touch the one special case of Innis is that we put L1 to 0, so we have U from B to 0, right? I have touched that situation in my supplement I sent you a few days ago. But now I want to concentrate on this case, this boundary condition, because this is much more simpler. So it can be, again, it can be verified that VB is a vector subspace of L2 R. Okay. Now, so the Bessel, so we call the Bessel Sturm Liouville operator L from U to 1 over X minus X U prime plus U square X U, correct? So this is from V to maybe I write this in this way. From VB, sorry, to L2R, U goes to 1 over X minus X prime plus nu square X. So this is our operator, right? This operator is self adjoint, okay, with respect to the weighting function R of x equal to x. So that means that LU V, so we take the inner product with respect to the weighting function R is equal to this inner product. Okay? I.e. 0 to B X equal to 0 to B X U for all UV in this vector subspace. Right? So we have already showed that in here. Okay, so we are make sure that this is the situation. Okay, so I stop here for a short recess time, okay, and then I will continue the discussion later.